Hi guys, my name is Anuj Jindal. Welcome to another session on preparing for RBI Grade B Phase 2 examination. So in this session, just like last session, we are going to cover a total of 65 questions. And these 65 questions have been taken this time from test 4 of ESI. So if you want to take the test first, you can do so very easily by just going online and taking the test. If you want to analyze the test with me first, you can do so as well through this lesson. So in this lesson, I'm not just going to tell you the answers of the questions like many other people are doing. I'm also going to tell you the topic that you have to cover through that question. A lot of topics I will be covering in brief immediately after the questions, one by one through the explanations. And a lot of topics I will be asking you to cover on your own as I cover the questions. The objective is simple. To be able to study together and ensure that we are able to cover as many topics as possible before the onslaught of the examination. So let us start with the session from ESI test 4 of RBI 2019. So let us start first with two markers, and then after covering all the two markers, we will be starting with one markers. This test will also give you a very clear idea as to what kind of questions can be asked as two markers and what kind of questions can be asked as one markers in the examination. So the first question does not have any information or any paragraph. It's a direct question and a very factual question. Looks like a very factual question. Let's go through the question. The question says, as per the report on the first comprehensive estimate of disease burden due to child and maternal malnutrition published by India State Level Disease Burden Initiative, malnutrition is still the leading risk factor for death in children under 5 years. Among all the malnutrition indicators, which of the following is the biggest contributor to disease burden? So the homework for you is to read this report on estimate of disease burden published by India State Level Disease Burden Initiative. Now this pertains to September 2019, so it's also available in ESI Current Affairs monthly. And if you Google it, you will also find it available in various newspapers, the analysis of this, whether Hindu, whether Live Mint, or whether Business Standard, all the leading newspapers have an analysis of this particular initiative's report. Okay. So as per the report, the leading cause of malnutrition is, unlike people think that it should be anemia or it should be stunting, but the leading cause of malnutrition is low birth weight, E. So the answer to this question is E, low birth weight. As I said, picked up from ESI Current, September 2019. Next question is, as per the India Iodine Survey 2018-19, again taken from September 2019, you can cover it in ESI September 2019 Current Affairs monthly as well. Which state has the lowest consumption of iodized salt despite being the third largest producer of salt in the country? The answer to this question is D, Tamil Nadu. Although it is one of the leading salt producers of the country, lowest consumption of iodized salt was found in the state of Tamil Nadu. Next question, what is the target? A very easy question, I would say this one. I think it's a low-hanging fruit. What is the target of renewable energy capacity to be achieved by 2022 set by the Ministry of New and Renewable Energy? The answer is 175 gigawatts. I discussed it in last session as well, wherein I was analyzing the entire test 5 of ESI. Out of this, 40 gigawatt is to be captured through solar rooftop grid connected energy, renewable energy, okay, and the remaining through various other sources of renewable energy. So the answer is C. Next question is, according to Niti Aayog's report, India's energy storage mission, a Make in India opportunity for globally competitive battery manufacturing, by when should India achieve 100% electric vehicles fleet? The answer is B, by 2030. Is the target of India to achieve 100% electric vehicles as per this report. Now this report is also available, or a brief summary and major points of this report are also available in ESI September 2019. So please cover that. So this is the homework for you. Next question, the Hindu Kush Himalaya Assessment Report has been released by International Center for Integrated Mountain Development, ICMOD. Which of the following is not an observation under the report? Now, before we move forward, you must be thinking why we are not discussing all these reports from where the questions have been picked. The reason is simple. The reports are very big and the summaries are also not small. They are also big enough. Therefore, if I start covering them, one question might take about 5 to 10 minutes, and therefore I don't want to waste that much time, and you should also be putting that much effort at the same time. Okay. So the question is, Hindu Kush Himalaya assessment report has been released by IKIMOD. Which of the following is not an observation under the report? A. More than 35% of glaciers in the region would retreat by 2100, even if global temperature rise is capped as 1.5 degree centigrade, which is very unlikely. A global temperature increase of 1.5 degree Celsius could mean at least a 1.8 degree Celsius temperature rise in the Hindu Kush Himalayas because of the problem of less albedo. If, in case you don't know what albedo is, go and find it out. It'll take just 2 minutes. Okay, Google it. Hindu Kush Himalayan region is a heat sink in summer and a heat source in winter. Yes, it is a heat sink in summer and a heat source in winter. The receding glaciers could cause drying up of the rivers during the monsoon. Now, this is incorrect. The receding glaciers will not cause drying up of rivers during the monsoon. The reason being, during the monsoon, it's not the the glaciers which provide majority of the water, but it's the monsoon which provides majority of the water to the rivers. Therefore, the receding glaciers will cause or could cause drying up of the rivers in the summers and winters, but not in the monsoon. So the answer to this question, which is not an incorrect observation, not a correct observation, is option D. Which of the following are reasons for an expansionary monetary policy of RBI? Now, this is a very conceptual question. Which of the following are reasons for an expansionary monetary policy of RBI? If the inflation is less, do we expand our monetary policy or do we contract our monetary policy? We expand. If the growth is low, we expand our monetary policy. If the crude oil prices increase, what do we do? Do we increase or expand our monetary policy or contract? Confusing, right? If this softer international monetary conditions, if the monetary conditions in international market are soft, which means they're also following an expansionary monetary policy, we also have to follow an expansionary monetary policy in order to compete with them. So 1, 2 and 4 are certainly correct, right? 3, doubtful. But there is no option saying 1, 2 and 4. Therefore, out of sheer logic, the answer comes out to be A, wherein all are correct. If the crude oil prices go up, then the growth, turns towards a slowdown. When the growth turns towards a slowdown or the growth reduces, then you have to go towards an expansionary monetary policy in order to push up the growth. But if the crude oil prices are high and at the same time inflation also becomes way too high, then you cannot follow an expansionary monetary policy. Therefore, increase in crude oil prices does not directly mean an expansionary monetary policy, but it could mean an expansionary monetary policy depending on the condition of inflation and growth simultaneously. So the answer is A for this question, which is the best option. Next question, we have a paragraph on total final consumption. You can go through this paragraph. The paragraph says, within total final consumption, it is the private final consumption expenditure that has a major share, close to 60% in the economy's GDP, with its growth rate mostly being higher than the overall GDP growth rate. The huge size of the economy serves as a big market for businesses, and a lot of other information provided about private final consumption expenditure and government final consumption expenditure. The question is, why has government final consumption expenditure decelerated in 2018-19? Now, this question comes from Economic Survey 2019. Okay, and the paragraph is also taken from there only. The question is, why has the government final consumption expenditure decelerated in 2018-19? The survey says the reason is A, because of government's revenue expenditure on compensation of employees going down. That means the government either is not hiring enough, or the retirements are more than what the government is hiring, or the government is not paying enough to its employees, which is very evident. You see all around the problem of high unemployment, and at the same time, a lot of debates about why the government is not hiring enough employees, why the government is not expanding at the same rate that was happening in the previous government. So yes, the government's revenue expenditure on compensation of employees has gone down. So the answer option is option A. If you've gone through the summary of survey or the original document, you would be able to understand it in a more detailed manner. Otherwise, yes, this could create problems because this is something that has been picked up directly from the economic survey itself. Okay, but you can eliminate certain things. For example, capital expenditure on defense has certainly not gone down. Capital expenditure on social welfare schemes has certainly not gone down. Revenue collection from GST is not as per the targets, but it has not gone down. It has increased from 60,000 to 70,000 crores per month to about 95,000 crores per month. Okay, therefore it has not gone down. Next question, match the following for data of 2018-19. Another question picked up from the economic survey, the recent one. It says WPI inflation, which of the following is the correct percentage for WPI inflation, CPI combined for 2018-19, fiscal deficit and revenue deficit. See, revenue deficit is the lowest at 2.3%, that I think should be very clear. Fiscal deficit is at 3.4%, that is very clear. And we have been going through the news, I think I gave an essay also, why is there a gap between WPI and CPI, and WPI is more than CPI, whereas it should be normally otherwise. WPI should be less than CPI, but in the present scenario, WPI is more than CPI. So the answer is ABCD is a direct relationship with 1, 2, 3, 4. So the answer is option A. Next question, what is the ratio of capital expenditure to total expenditure of the central government in 2018-19? Ratio of capital expenditure to total expenditure. It is very, very less at 13%. Again, another question from Economic Survey 2019. If you've gone through the survey or at least the summary, you should be able to answer this. So what you have to do is at least go through the 15-page summary that I have created of Economic Survey. You would be able to answer majority of these factual and conceptual questions. Next question, central government receipts can broadly be divided into non-debt and debt receipts. Non-debt receipts comprise of tax revenue, non-tax revenue, recovery of loans, and debt receipts mostly comprise of the following, which have been given here. The question is, the new fiscal targeting framework rests on two pillars. Which of the following are these two pillars? So the new fiscal targeting, as per again Economic Survey 2019, rests on two pillars, and these two pillars of fiscal targeting are reducing fiscal deficit and reducing overall debt. These two are the targets. It is not reducing fiscal deficit and increasing debt. It is logical. The fiscal target cannot be to increase debt. Reducing revenue deficit and encouraging monetary policy easing. Now, monetary policy easing is a part of monetary policy making, not a part of fiscal targeting. Therefore, it can also not be logically correct. Reducing fiscal deficit and inflation control. Yes, you might get confused and think that inflation control might be one of the targets of fiscal targeting framework, but that is not correct. The target as per economic survey is twofold: fiscal, reducing fiscal deficit and reducing overall debt. So the answer option is B. Next question, consider the following statements about central and state government finances and find out the correct one. Another question directly picked up from economic survey, a very conceptual and factual mix of concepts and facts. 51% of gross tax revenue comprises of direct taxes and 49% indirect taxes, that is correct. Total transfer to states have risen between 14 to 18, revised estimates, this is also correct. Total liabilities of central government as a ratio of GDP have been consistently declining. Total liabilities of the central government, particularly after the enactment of FRBM Act, yes, it is also correct. Transfers to states as a percentage of GDP is 6.6% of GDP. So good fact that you get from where a question can be asked, this is also correct. With this, again, another homework, if you've not gone through the economic survey summary at least till now, do it before moving on to the next question or write it down somewhere. After we're done with the entire session, you are required to go through the entire summary, 50-page summary, at least once, if you are getting these answers wrong. So the answer option is A, all are correct. Which union ministry has launched a 10-year national rural sanitation framework to sustain India's 100% open defecation free status? Now, open defecation free and sanitation have been brought under Ministry of Jal Shakti. So the answer is C, Ministry of Jal Shakti. National Population Register. Okay, so this question again comes from September. I believe it has been announced in September or August, if I'm not very sure, if I'm not wrong, that National Population Register is going to come out with an annual database as well. And the features have also been mentioned. Now, the question is, we have to consider the below statements about National Population Register. Statement 1 says NPR database would contain only demographic details. No, along with demographic, they will also contain biometric details of individuals. A resident identity card will be issued to individuals over the age of 18. UID number will also be printed on the card. We have to find out incorrect statements. The exercise will be carried out across the country except Delhi. No, it will be carried out across the country except Assam. For Assam, a different exercise of identifying the population, which is a part of India, who are citizens of India, is carried out separately for Assam. So, statement 3 is wrong and statement 1 is wrong. 1 and 3 are wrong, 2 is correct. In this case, I have told you the correct answer as well. So, yes, it is from ESI current August 2019. In accordance to the announcement made in Union Budget, the government has issued a scheme regarding one-time partial credit guarantee to public sector banks. This I have discussed in Finance Current Affairs as well. So, in Finance Current, I have already discussed it. If you have not seen those videos, please go on Infinity and watch them. Very important. Which Department of Ministry of Finance is providing the guarantee? Details about the partial credit, what is 10% of what, etc., etc., are available in this Finance Current video as well as the documents of Finance Current. The answer is Department of Economic Affairs. So, Department of Economic Affairs from Ministry of Finance is going to be providing this guarantee of up to 10%. Next question, more than 100 stakeholders consultations on Mega Free Trade Agreement, RCEP. Now, RCEP detailed document is covered under Finance Current for November, which has already been provided from 1 to 10th to the enrolled students. So, please go through that immediately. I am expecting 2-3 questions from RCEP. What are the statements? RCEP is proposed between member countries of SAARC. No, it is not between member countries of SAARC. It is between member countries of ASEAN and some other nations are a part of it. If it is passed, it will become the world's biggest free trade pact. This is correct. India and China together comprise RCEP's biggest component in terms of market size. This is also correct. So, we have to identify the correct statements. 2 and 3 are correct. 1 is incorrect. Answer option is B. National Population Register. Another question. We've already discussed National Population Register. Therefore, this question might already have been done. The question is, the exercise of recording data will be carried out all over India except one state, and I told you that state is Assam. So, the answer option is Assam in this case. Railways privatization, the committee headed by Vivek Debroy gave its recommendations. We have already discussed it in ESI Current Affairs. Let's take up a question on recommendations of Vivek Debroy committee on rail privatization. We have to identify which one of them is not one of the recommendations. The committee has favored privatization of rolling stock, wagons and coaches. Yes. The committee has recommended creation of a separate company for infrastructure. Yes, it has. The committee has recommended open access for new operators who wish to enter the market for operating trains. Yes, it has. But it has not recommended an independent railways authority for maintaining railway infrastructure and quality of services. It does not say anything about creation of a national independent railways authority. So, this is incorrect. The next one is about multidimensional poverty index. Now, this question is very controversial, going to be very controversial because I picked up some things directly from the MPI. The question is, consider the following statements about MPI 2019 and find out the correct one. So, we have to find out the correct statements. Across 101 countries, 1.3 billion people are multidimensionally poor. This is correct. There is no association between economic inequality and MPI value. This is correct. This looks incorrect, but this is correct. There is no little association. Why? Because in countries where there is high economic inequality, there might be a high MPI, low MPI value as well, and a high MPI value as well. Therefore, inequality does not necessarily mean that your multidimensional poverty index is going to be high or low. A country might be very poor, but at the same time, inequality might be low. A country might have high inequality, and at the same time, very less number of people might be poor. Therefore, there is no little association between inequality and MPI value. In dimensions of MPI, if no household member aged 10 years or older has completed 6 years of schooling, then he or she is considered uneducated. This is correct. Bihar was still the poorest state with more than half of its population living in poverty. This is also correct. So all the options are correct. The answer option is D. Next question, which of the following are correct amendments proposed by the cabinet in POXO Act 2019 available in ESI Current Affairs? Please go through the entire amendments list as well. A new provision of death penalty in cases of sexual offences against children. Yes, it has. A new provision to levy fines and imprisonment to curb child pornography. Yes. It provides for special courts that conduct the trial in camera without revealing the identity of the child. Yes. The Act stipulates that a case of child sexual abuse must be disposed of within 1 year from the date of offence is reported. Yes, this has also been included in the POXO Amendment Act. So all the options are correct. The answer becomes A. The next question is about election. Says something about election, and it's a long paragraph. You can go through the paragraph. You can pause the video and go through the paragraph if you want to. Let's see if we can answer the question without the paragraph also. The following steps have been taken for women empowerment in the Union Budget 2019-20 except. So it's a question which talks about steps on women empowerment announced in Union Budget, need not necessarily be connected to the paragraph. Overdraft of 5,000 to be allowed for every verified women self-help group member having a Jandan bank account. This has been announced. 1 women per self-help group to be eligible for a loan of up to rupees 1 lakh under Mudra. Yes. Women self-help group interest subvention program proposed to be expanded to all districts. Yes. And women self-help group to be included under priority sector lending framework. No, this has not been announced. This is not a reality. This is something that I just made up, not announced in the budget. So the answer is 1, 2 and 3 have been introduced. Fourth one has not been introduced in the budget 2019. Next question, the price stabilization fund was set up in 2014-15 under Department of Agricultural and Farmers Welfare to help regulate the price volatility of important agri-horticultural commodities. In 2016, it was transferred to which department? So price stabilization fund was transferred to Department of Consumers Affairs. The answer option is C. Price stabilization fund was set up to regulate the price volatility of important agri-horticultural commodities like onion, potatoes and pulses. It was set up in 2014 with a corpus of 500 crore under Department of Agriculture, but transferred to Department of Consumer Affairs in 2016. A very small information, yet very important, because prices of onions recently went up again. Therefore, this question can also be asked. The next question is, Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana, launched in 2011 and renamed in 2015, aims at uplifting the poor families of the nation. This scheme aims to achieve its goal through which of the following methods? By providing food grains to rural and urban poor at low cost. So these are the keywords. By providing free medical help to poor families at primary, secondary and tertiary level. By providing free and inclusive education. And the fourth one is by providing sustainable livelihood opportunities through skill development. Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana. This is a very important scheme, a very old scheme, yet a very important scheme. Therefore, questions can be asked in this way. In this question, the objective of the scheme has been asked directly. So your homework is to read everything possible about Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana before moving on to the next question, so that you are very well revised with this scheme. The answer to this question is D, sustainable livelihood opportunities through skill development. A little bit about this Yojana. It was launched in 2011, as is mentioned in this question itself. National Rural Livelihood Mission or Ajivika has been in November 2015, and the program was renamed as Deen Dayal Antyodaya Yojana. It was launched as National Rural Livelihood Mission or Ajivika, but renamed as this. Implemented under Ministry of Rural Development, this is very important, can be asked in the examination, so mark it. Aims at enhancing livelihood through employment and enterprises. Basic idea is to organize the poor into self-help groups. So the idea is very simple, you organize people, bring them together into clusters of self-help groups, and then you provide them livelihood. Next question, before reading the paragraph, make sure that you go through the question so that you know whether you can answer the question without going through the paragraph or not. In the given context, Finance Minister is talking about two schemes, so you have to go through the question. One of the scheme is launched by Ministry of Petroleum and another by Ministry of Power. So the question has been flipped. Normally you are given a scheme and you have to answer which ministry, under which ministry is it launched. In this question, the ministries are given, you have to tell which scheme belongs to which ministry, okay? The paragraph is, they have transformed the lives of every rural family, and by 2020, the 75th year, every single rural family will have electricity and a clean cooking facility. So these are the objectives of these schemes. Household access to clean cooking gas has seen an unprecedented expansion. So it's about clean cooking gas through provision of more than 7 crore LPG connections. All villages and almost 100% households have been provided with electricity. So one of them comes under Ministry of Petroleum, another comes under Ministry of Power. Probably the one related to LPG comes under Ministry of Petroleum and the one related with electricity comes under Ministry of Power. Now we have to identify which one comes under what and which scheme are they talking about. The options are Ujwala Saubhagya, Urja Ganga Ujwala, Swadhar Grah, PM Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana, Annapurna and Deendayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana. The answer is A, Ujwala, which belongs under Ministry of Petroleum for LPG, and Saubhagya, which is for 100% electrification under Ministry of Power. A little bit about these schemes. Ujwala, launched by Ministry of Petroleum for providing cooking gas, and Saubhagya for under Ministry of Power to provide electricity. Both the schemes, Pradhan Mantri, Urja Ganga and Ujwala, both of them have been launched by Ministry of Petroleum. The third is Swadhar Grah, Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar Yojana. Swadhar Grah, launched by Ministry of Women and Child Development. So read about these schemes as well, so that you are revised about these schemes simultaneously. And Sahaj Bijli Har Ghar is for Ministry of Power. Annapurna scheme, launched by Ministry of Rural Development. And Deendayal Upadhyay Gram Jyoti Yojana, Ministry of Power. So read about these additional schemes simultaneously. This way you will be able to move through different schemes very fast, flip through different schemes very fast. You do not have to spend a lot of time on them. The question, next question is, the reason behind India's rise as a startup nation is Startup India initiative taken by Ministry of Commerce. Under the scheme, the startups are eligible for angel tax exemption whose total investment does not exceed how much. So you have to identify, it's a factual question, yet it is a two marker. So doesn't mean that if there is a two marker, it has to be an analytical question. Behind a particular concept, the whatever facts remain, they can also be asked. The answer is C, 25 crore. Startup India initiative is an initiative of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. It was launched in 2016 for promotion of startups. So launched in 2016, Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Funding, support and tax exemption is provided under this. Eligibility criteria to avail angel tax exemption. The new eligibility criteria is as follows. Investment has to be less than 25 crore. The capital and share premium, paid up share capital and share premium, also should not exceed 25 crore. And startups are exempted from income tax for 3 years and for angel tax for 10 years. So all the recognized startups can apply for this exemption as well. Angel tax 10 years, income tax 3 years in any of the 10 years that it chooses to. Next question. It was a powerful galvanizing call to action India's citizen and business leaders. This is a paragraph which has been picked up, looks like it has been picked up randomly. The question is, now it's an interesting question because some changes have been made in this answer now. A positive response of the campaign Make in India, a type of Swadeshi movement, have seen in the World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Report 2019. In the report, India ranks dash in 2019, an improvement from the rank of dash in 2016 out of 190 countries. So some changes have been made here. The new list has come out according to which India is ranked at 63rd position for 2020. And therefore, if a question is asked, it will be asked for 2020 only. Therefore, the answer 77-130, although they are important, remember the latest ranking, which is 63, an improvement of 14. Next question, nothing to mention here or nothing to explain here. Next question is about FDI. Now, this is a very interesting question. It tests your ability to remember all the limits of FDI in different areas. To promote India as an important investment destination and a global hub for manufacturing, design and innovation, various sectors have been opened up for FDI under the campaign Make in India launched by Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Three sectors of the economy are not permitted for 100% FDI except. Now, some of these sectors are not permitted for 100% FDI and some of these sectors are permitted for 100% FDI. We have to identify which sectors are permitted for 100% FDI. Please remember the question clearly. Read the question clearly. It says three sectors are not permitted for 100% FDI except. So we have to identify sectors which are eligible for FDI. Space industry, not permitted. Defense, not permitted for 100% FDI. Some percentage of FDI is allowed. Media, not yet permitted for 100% FDI. Private insurance, now yes, it is permitted for 100% FDI, and the same is with railway projects, permitted with 100% FDI. So the answer to this question is 4, option 4 and option 5, that is C. 100% FDI is permitted in all 27 sectors except space, defense and media, 26%. So these are the 3 percentage allowances of FDI in these 3 sectors. Next question. The above context is explaining one of the schemes under the Ministry of Food Processing Industries in which one-time capital grant is given to the projects. What is the correct option about the pattern of assistance provided under the scheme? We have to identify the pattern of assistance provided under the scheme as one-time capital grant. In general areas, 55% and in hilly areas, 75% of project cost. Financial assistance is capped at 50 crore. In general areas, 50% and in hilly areas, 70%. Let me tell you the exact answer. The answer is in general areas, 50% and in hilly areas, 75%. And the cap for both of them is 50 crore. So if we make all these, if we know about all these, we will come to know that the answer option of this is option B. Every other option has some or the other error. Okay. So the answer option is B. The Mega Food Park scheme was launched in 2018, implemented under Ministry of Food Processing Industry. In general areas, the financial assistance is 50% of project cost, subject to a maximum of 50 crore. And in hilly areas, again, 75% of project cost, subject to a maximum of 50 crore. Next question about social trends and growing urbanization. There is some paragraph. Let's go through the question and see if we can answer it without going through the paragraph also. The question says, under the scheme PM Bharatiya Jan Aushadhi Pariyojana, a financial assistance is given to open the Jan Aushadhi stores. What is not correct about the financial help provided to open the Jan Aushadhi stores? So this is about Jan Aushadhi stores, the financial assistance which is being provided by the government. One time financial assistance 2.5 lakh inside the hospital. If you are opening a Jan Aushadhi store inside the hospital. Incentive up to 2.5 lakh at 15% of monthly sales, subject to a ceiling of 10,000 per month for opening Jan Aushadhi store outside the hospital. Medicines worth 70,000 in advance with the incentive of 2.5 lakh to weaker sections for opening Jan Aushadhi store. Incentive is 15% subject to a monthly ceiling of 15,000 up to a total limit of 2.5 lakh for special areas. So these are the 4 options that are given here, and we have to identify which of the following is not correct about the financial help provided. C is not correct about the financial help provided. All other options are correct. So please remember all the other options as well. They may play around with these options as well. Okay. Now the correct answer to this is 50,000 in advance with an incentive of 2.5 lakh to weaker sections, which includes SCST differently abled. Okay. So SCST differently abled are the weaker sections which are provided 50,000 in advance for medicines and 2.5 lakh incentive. All the other options, all the other provisions are correct. So please go through them before going forward with the next question. Next question is about urea. The question is, in January 2015, the government allowed the urea producers to produce up to 100% of production as neem coated urea under neem coating urea policy. Later on, the government made it mandatory for producers of domestic urea to keep a certain percentage as neem coated. What is the range of mandatory neem coated urea? So the range is 70 to 80%. So 70 to 80% is the minimum range in which you have to produce neem coated urea only and not any other kind of urea. Neem coating urea policy was launched in 2015. This policy is made up by Department of Fertilizers under Ministry of Chemical. Now, Ministry of Chemical is not connected with social welfare, so you would normally feel that this question or this area is not that important. Yes, might be, might not be asked, but neem coating of urea has been in use for quite some time, therefore the question has been placed here. Next question is about Niryat Bandhu scheme for Skill India and Digital India. The question is, Niryat Bandhu scheme has been galvanized and repositioned to achieve the objectives of Skill India and Digital India. It is launched to get new and potential exporters into international trade and boost exports from India. What is the key measure of this program to assist exporters? That means, how does this program assist exporters and is trying to increase exports of India? Number one, by providing financial assistance as loan at lower rate of interest, by mentoring new and potential exporters by conducting counseling sessions, by helping exporters in accessing credit at reduced rates, by reducing specific export obligation from 90% to 75% of the normal export obligation. So these are the four options which are provided, and then certain options are there. You have to prove the right one. Now here, 1, 2 and 3, that is option B is the correct option. 1, 2 and 3 are key measures. Now why is 4th not a correct measure, and what are these key measures which are correct? Let's go through them again. Financial assistance is provided as loan to exporters at lower rate of interest. Exporters are provided credit at reduced rates as well. New and potential exports are provided counseling sessions and orientation programs. Yes. However, export obligation is not reduced, because this is something that is specific to banks. The Niryat Bandhu scheme cannot, you know, touch this or reduce this, because if the exporter is dealing with a private bank, this export obligation can certainly not be reduced. And insurance companies are also involved there. That's why 1, 2 and 3 are correct options, 4th one is incorrect. Next question is about protecting the interest of farmers. RISPC has been launched. Now what is RISPC? RISPC is Revenue Insurance Scheme for Plantation Crops. Revenue Insurance Scheme for Plantation Crops. The question is, to protect the interest of farmers and to protect from adverse weather conditions, RISPC was launched. Which group of crops is not insured? Which group of crops is not insured under RISPC? Tobacco, cardamom and cotton are not insured under RISPC. And this particular paragraph is also on RISPC. Therefore, please go through the paragraph as well. RISPC is an insurance scheme launched to protect growers of tea, coffee, rubber, cardamom and tobacco. Tea, coffee, rubber, cardamom and tobacco, therefore cotton is not a part of it, hence answer D is the incorrect one. Launched in 2016, implemented by commodity boards, not important. Farmers having 10 hectares or less land holding can be benefited or can use this scheme. Okay, so this is an important one, an important provision or an important feature which can be asked in the examination as well. The question is on Integrate to Innovate program. Is a 3-month program for startups developed to invest India. It was launched with the partnership of which sector companies? Integrate to Innovate program. The name is Integrate to Innovate program. The paragraph is also on this. So let's go through the paragraph and see if we can answer it even if we don't know. The program Integrate to Innovate provides an opportunity for collaboration and conversation around valuable dash transitions, offering startups an opportunity to bring their ideas to life with the guidance and support from corporates. The selected startups will receive a cash prize grant of 5 lakh along with opportunity to pilot their projects with corporates. The corporates would offer them access to technology, technical and commercial mentorship and access to potential customers through the corporate network of partners. The paragraph certainly does not help you to answer the question, however, tells you a lot about Integrate to Innovate program. So go through this once again and remember all the provisions related to Integrate to Innovate program, whatever I am highlighting here. The answer to this question is C, energy. In the energy sector, this is being carried out. Launched in 2018, the selected startups, as I said, 5 lakh per startup, that is the amount of prize grant that they will receive, and they will also get direct help from these energy companies. The next question is regarding PM Sampada Yojana. The question is, an umbrella scheme, PM Kisan Sampada, approved for the period of 2016-20, expected to benefiting 20 lakh farmers, is related to which ministry? So PM Sampada is related to which ministry? Ministry of Food Processing, Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Rural Development, Ministry of Commerce and Industry. The answer to this question is C, Ministry of Food Processing. And with this, you are required to read everything about PM Sampada as well immediately. The full form of Sampada is Scheme for Agro Marine Processing and Development of Agro Processing Clusters. Remember this full form. Very high chances this is going to be asked in the examination. The outlay is 6,000 crore. Launched under Ministry of Food Processing Industries. Aimed to provide a big boost to the growth of food processing. An umbrella scheme incorporating ongoing schemes. Not important. Next question is related to Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. Rurban Mission follows a cluster-based approach. Neighboring gram panchayats in plains with a population of dash to dash are selected to form a cluster. So we have to identify in plains what is the limit of population to be forming a cluster under Shyama Prasad Mukherjee Rurban Mission. The outlay is 5142 crore. That is important. Please remember that as well. The answer is B, 25,000 to 50,000 population gram panchayats come under the cluster based of Rurban Mission. It was launched in 2016. It aimed at strengthening rural areas by provisioning of economic, social and physical infrastructure. Follows cluster based and population 25,000 to 50,000 in plain and coastal areas, 5,000 to 15,000 in desert, hilly or tribal areas. Remember these provisions, very important from examination point of view. Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, NGNREGA, is an employment scheme launched to enhance livelihood security. Lot of stuff related about MGNREGA. With regard to this scheme, choose the relevant and appropriate statements among the following. It was launched as National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2007, which is incorrect. At least one-third beneficiaries shall be women. No, that is also incorrect. Wages are linked to CPI, agricultural labor. If work is not provided within 20 days, employment allowance is going to be provided. And MGNREGA is to be implemented mainly by gram panchayats. We have to identify relevant and appropriate statements. That means the correct statements. The answer to this question is C, 2, 3 and 5 are correct. 2 is correct. At least one-third beneficiaries shall be women. I thought it's one-half. No, it is one-third. At least a third of beneficiaries have to be women. Third is correct. 2, 3 and 5 are correct. Third is wages are linked to CPI, which is correct. And it is implemented mainly by gram panchayats. Fourth is not correct because if work is not provided within 15 days of applying, then applicants are entitled to unemployment allowance. And it was not under National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2007, but 2005, National Rural Employment Guarantee Act 2005, okay. These are all provisions under MGNREGA. Majority of them have been mentioned there only. A 60-40 wage and material ratio has to be maintained. So 60% of the money has to go into wages and 40% can only go in material. Let us now move towards certain one markers. The first question is, what is the implementing agency of the scheme Pandit Deen Dayal Upadhyay Unnat Krishi Shiksha Yojana, an initiative of Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare to promote agricultural education in the country? Implementing agency of this scheme. These kinds of factual questions can also be asked in the examination. So do remember if there is any implementing agency. Your homework for this question is to identify or look for the full forms of all these acronyms that have been provided here, because all these acronyms hold some or the other importance. The answer to this question is ICAR, Indian Council for Agricultural Research. Okay. A little bit about Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay Unnat Krishi Shiksha Scheme, launched in 2015 under Ministry of Agriculture, implemented by Education Division of ICAR. 100 centers have been opened with a fund of 5.35 crore. 5-day training program is provided under Unnat Krishi Shiksha Scheme. Next question, Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana, PKVY, launched in 2015 to promote organic farming through a cluster approach to adopt DASH. Which of them? AgMark, IQS, ISO, Participatory Guarantee Scheme Certification or Indian Organic Certification? The answer is C. Participatory Guarantee Scheme Certification is adopted under the organic farming vision of Paramparagat Krishi Vikas Yojana. Launched under Ministry of Agriculture, an extended component of soil health management under National Mission on Sustainable Agriculture. Purpose is to promote organic farming. Organic farming is promoted through a cluster-based approach. And PGS, Participatory Guarantee Scheme Certification, facilitates farmers to certify their organic produce, which helps in getting better price and more credibility. Next question, what is the National Coordinating Institute to implement Spark Scheme launched for promotion of academic and research collaboration between Indian and foreign institutions? The full form of Spark, that is something that you have to look for. I might also be discussing it shortly. And also everything about Spark Scheme, you have to revise it immediately. The answer is A, IIT Kharagpur. Spark stands for Scheme for Promotion of Academic and Research Collaboration, Spark. Launched for promotion of academic and research collaboration by collaborating between Indian and foreign universities. There are certain provisions regarding NIRF rankings and Quaccarelli-Simons rankings for Indian and foreign universities. You have to revise them. I'm not going to tell you right now, although I remember them, but I want you to revise them. Okay. Next question. RUSA is a centrally sponsored scheme to increase enrollment in higher education by 30% by 2020. DASH portal is a part of implementation of RUSA funded works. The answer to this question is A. Bhuvan RUSA is the name of the portal for implementation of RUSA funded works for increasing enrollment in higher education by 30%, not to 30% by 2020. RUSA was launched in 2013 by Ministry of HRD. The purpose is to improve access, equity and quality in higher education. So RUSA is limited to higher education only. Okay. Next question, under the AAY, Antyodaya Anna Yojana, eligible families are to be given a unique Antyodaya Ration Card, which is also called as PDS Dash Card. So Antyodaya Ration Card is also called as PDS Dash Card. The answer is B, yellow. It's also called as PDS Yellow Card. Antyodaya Anna Yojana is a scheme to provide food grains at highly subsidized rates to the poorest of poor families. It is still ongoing even after National Food Security Act was passed. It was launched, Anna Yojana was launched in 2000 by Ministry of Consumer Affairs. Beneficiary families are given 35 kg of rice and wheat at the rate of 3 per kg rice and 2 per kg wheat. And coarse grains are now also being distributed at the rate of 1 per kg. And they are provided with a card which is also called as PDS Yellow Card. Next question is about GDP. So this is from either macroeconomics or Indian economy. The question is, which among the following is or are correct reasons for core GVA growth being higher than overall GVA growth in India in 2018-19? A very good question. Looks like a two marker. The core inflation has been higher than overall inflation. Growth in agriculture and PubAd has been higher than growth in other sectors. Growth in agriculture and PubAd has been lower than growth in other sectors. Core inflation is lower than overall inflation. Please try to answer this question on your own as well. So we are comparing between core inflation, overall inflation, growth in agriculture and public administration, and growth in other sectors. Which of the following is correct reason for core GVA growth being higher than overall GVA growth? What are the reasons? In order to understand the answer to this question, you need to understand what are the reasons which can affect core GVA growth and overall GVA growth. Now, it should be very clear to you, let me tell you that GVA growth or core GVA growth and overall GVA growth cannot be affected by inflation in the short run. Therefore, both these two options related to inflation are incorrect because they do not have any impact on increasing the core GVA growth or keeping it higher than overall GVA growth. Now, the doubt is between whether growth in agriculture and PBAD has been higher than growth in other sectors or has it been lower. Now, core GVA growth is GVA growth which excludes areas like public administration, defense, agriculture, etc. And therefore, because of a reduction in agriculture, PBAD and defense, overall GVA growth has gone down and core GVA growth has remained up. Therefore, the answer is 3. Growth in agriculture and PBAD has been lower than growth in other sectors, and because agriculture, PBAD, defense, etc. are a part of overall GVA growth, they have pulled down overall GVA growth in India. So the answer is E, only 3 is correct. Next question, which of the following explains the reasons for impact of deceleration in NBFC sector on GDP growth? Reasons for impact of a deceleration in NBFC on GDP growth. Stress in NBFC has affected consumption finance, thus affecting GDP. Stress in NBFC has affected banking sector credit growth. Stress in NBFC has affected bond market, and stress in NBFC has affected the equity market. Which of the following, according to you, should be the right answer? The answer is A. NBFC has directly affected consumption finance. Banking sector credit growth has nothing to do or not major to do with NBFC. Why? Because it's the banking sector which provides credit to NBFC and not otherwise. So if there is a stress in NBFC, that doesn't mean that banking sector is affected. Banking sector is the credit provider, but according to option B, NBFC is the credit provider, which is incorrect. Therefore, option A is the most correct one. NBFC, because they provide a lot of loans to, you know, retail sectors like housing, automobile, etc., they have affected consumption finance and that has affected GDP growth in India. Next question, government has recently launched National Pension Scheme for traders and self-employed persons. It is a voluntary and contributory pension scheme. So, some statements about NPS are being provided. We have to identify the incorrect one. It is a scheme for traders with annual turnover up to 1.5 crore. The scheme guarantees minimum pension of 3,000 per month. The central government shall give 50% share of monthly contribution and remaining 50% will be made by beneficiary. The beneficiary should be in the age group of 18 to 40 and the beneficiary should be an income tax payer. We have to identify the incorrect one. The E point is incorrect because it is not necessary that beneficiary has to be an income tax payer, which is also quite logical. If a person is not income tax payer, the government or NPS, the organization, would be more than happy to have his have him come under social security net by taking him under NPS. Therefore, the beneficiary might or might not be an income taxpayer. That is the correct answer. Next question is, NBFCs are required to increase LCR in a progressive manner from 60% to 100% by which date? This I've also discussed many a times in phase 1 morning tales as well as whatever finance videos we create on a regular basis. The answer is April 1, 2024. By 2024, 1st April, LCR, liquidity coverage ratio for NBFCs has to be increased from 60% to 100%. This question, the next question is about core investment companies. And I think I discussed a question related to core investment companies in 2 markers as well. So it's a factual question, but please go through this paragraph. This paragraph is going to provide you a lot of information which you might not be aware about related to CICs. So please go through this paragraph. The question is simple and factual. Recently, RBI has set up a working group to review the regulatory and supervisory framework for core investment companies. The working group is to be headed by, the answer is A, Tapan Ray. Which of the following is not a part of balance of payments? Next question. Current account, capital account, official reserve transactions, and planned capital expenditure.
We have to identify which of them is not a part of balance of payments. The answer to this question is D, very obvious. Planned capital expenditure, non-planned capital expenditure, that distinguishment has been removed, number one. Okay, and they are meant to identify or to create some differentiation in the budget document, not in BOP. BOP consists of current account and capital account, very simple. Official reserve transactions are a part of either current account or capital account, depending upon what kind of transactions they are. But planned capital expenditure is not a part of BOP. Capital expenditure or capital receipts come under capital account, but planned capital expenditure is no head under BOP. According to J.M. Keynes, which of the following can help people make decisions in an uncertain environment? Government intervention, animal spirits, general knowledge, available insight with the decision maker. The answer to this question is animal spirits, and this was used very regularly by Dr. Manmohan Singh when he was the Prime Minister. And because he has been in news recently, therefore something like this related to, what he used to use a lot, taken from J.M. Keynes, can be asked at the examination. Which of the following terms denote number of unemployed persons as a percentage of labor force? Unemployed people as a percentage of labor force, the answer is unemployment rate, A. Now you need to, your homework is that you need to go through the definitions of all these four. Unemployment rate, worker population ratio, LFPR, all these three, not four. And where will you find it? You will find it in periodic labor force survey document, which I have provided already, and I believe you have gone through that. Okay. So in PLFS document, all the data related to PLFS has been provided, and simultaneously under PLFS, the definitions of these are also being provided. Which of the following is true as per Angel's law? Income elasticity of demand of food is between 0 and 1. Income elasticity of demand of food is between 0 and minus 1. Income elasticity of demand of food is 0. Income elasticity is perfectly elastic. In order to answer this question, let's first of all understand very briefly what exactly is Angel's law. So if I create a diagram, then it would be something which says that okay, this is your income which is rising, and let's say the food consumption is here, but food consumption starts falling. So this is your food consumption. To make it more to be more accurate with it, it will be something like this. So this is your income and this is your food consumption. So what it says is that as your income increases, Angel law says that as your income increases, your food consumption or the proportion of money spent on food reduces. It's not talking about an absolute reduction in money spent on food. Let's say your income is 1000 and then it becomes 3000. You are spending 50% of this 500 on food. You might be spending 1000 on food, but the proportion, this is about proportion and not, in absolute numbers. Proportion of money spent on food has gone down. It was 50%, now it is 33%. So Angel's law is nothing but it says that as your income rises, your proportion of money spent on food goes down, which means income elasticity of demand of food is between 0 and 1. So the answer is A. Which of the following is true regarding effective revenue deficit? It was introduced in the budget 2011-12. It is the difference between revenue deficit and grants for creation of capital assets. It is a fiscal parameter and all of the above. Now, effective revenue deficit has now been removed from, using it under the budget in order to identify different kinds of deficits or surpluses. Therefore, because it has been removed, it might be asked in the examination. The answer is D, all of the above are correct. Next question, Ministry of Women and Child Development felicitated states and districts under Beti Bachao Beti Padhao scheme for improvement in sex ratio at birth. Which district has shown greatest improvement in sex ratio at birth? A very factual question, nothing to explain here. The answer is coming in Arunachal Pradesh, if I'm not wrong. Recently, an advisory board for banking frauds, ABBF, has been constituted to examine bank fraud of over 50 crore and recommend action. Who has constituted this board? ABBF, Advisory Board for Banking Frauds, RBI, CBI, CVC, Enforcement Directorate, or none of the above? The answer is CVC. It is not RBI, it is CVC that has constituted ABBF. With this, you are required to read everything on CVC, on ABBF as well. That's your homework from this question. Next question is, the India Child Wellbeing Index report has been released by non-government organization World Vision India and IFMR Lead. The index measures the overall child being based on certain indicators. Overall child being based on certain indicators is measured by this index. Which of the following states of India has been ranked at the top as per this index? Related to World Vision India Child Wellbeing Index. Okay, Tamil Nadu, Himachal Pradesh, Puducherry, Kerala or Karnataka? The answer is Kerala. Very factual question. With this, you need to go through this India Child Wellbeing Index report. Which of the following sets of companies are eligible for reduced corporate tax rate of 25%? Now, this has been changed recently in the union budget. Therefore, important, the answer is E. If your turnover is below 400 crore, you have to pay a corporate tax rate of 25% now. Bharat Mala Pariyojana Phase 1 has been launched with an outlay of how much? A very good and factual question. The answer is A, 5,35,000 crore. That is the total outlay of Bharat Mala Pariyojana Phase 1. This is a long paragraph related to elections, as I can see here. And then you have a question on budget. In the budget 2019-20, the disinvestment target has been kept at dash. The answer is B, 1,05,000 crore. A very factual question, so you need not even go through this paragraph. Which of the following is not one of the theme-based circuits launched under Swadesh Darshan scheme? A very good question. There were 12 theme-based circuits. Now they have been increased to 15. But Jain circuit is still not one of the circuits. Jain circuit does not exist. There is no circuit named as Jain circuit. There are a total of 15 circuits. Your task is, and this is something that I've already mentioned in ESI Current Affairs, all the 15 circuits, I remember mentioning them myself. Your task is to go through all the 15 circuits and also to revise the three new circuits that have been added in this Swadesh Darshan scheme recently, because a question is highly expected. If not two marker, then at least a one marker. Then we have a question on diversity, some paragraph on diversity and drinking water. Let's look at the question. The question is related to Jal Shakti Abhiyan, that means water. Which among the following is or are conservation interventions under Jal Shakti Abhiyan? Rainwater harvesting, renovation of traditional water bodies, creation of reuse and recharge structures, watershed development, intensive afforestation, filtering of sea and salt water resources. Rainwater harvesting is certainly there. Renovation of traditional water bodies, certainly there. Creation of reuse and recharge structures, certainly there. Watershed development is also there. Filtering of sea and water sources is not there. So 6 is not, certainly not an option. So whichever has 6 can be removed. 1, 2, 3, 4 are certainly there. So you have 1, 2, 3, 4 in only this one. So by elimination, we come to the answer of E, and let's see if it is correct or not. Yes, the answer is E only. All 5 are correct. 6th one is incorrect. India is not a permanent member of UNSC. These are the reasons except. So which one of the following is not a reason for India not being given a permanent status in UNSC? It is a large liberal democracy. India is not a leading donor of UN. India's border dispute with China and Pakistan, poverty and low literacy rate. So we have to identify, first of all, what are the reasons that India is still not a permanent member of UNSC? Why is India still not a permanent member of UNSC? Because it does not donate that much to United Nations. Because it has border disputes. Therefore, if it becomes a permanent member, it will be having an impact on China and Pakistan. Therefore, China and Pakistan keep vetoing it, number one. And other countries do not want India to be in that situation, in that powerful situation, which creates some kind of instability. Because it has poverty and low literacy rate, it is not developed to that extent. Therefore, UNSC members do not want India to be on that table. However, India being a large liberal democracy is something that supports it becoming a permanent member of UNSC. Therefore, this is not one of the reasons. The answer is A. In the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, India plays its role as a dash, main member, dialogue partner, observer, and India is not a member of SCO. The answer is A, it's a main member. The Delhi High Court has ruled that United Nations is not a state under dash of the Constitution of India and is not amenable to its jurisdiction under dash of the Constitution. So these kinds of questions can be asked in the examination. Why? Because there was one question related to articles in phase 1. So there might be some questions in phase 2 as well. The answer is article 12 and article 226. I believe you can go through these articles in brief, or even if you go through this statement, you would be able to find out the context very easily. India finds OECD index for services trade 2018 faulty. Which one is not helping to prove this statement correct? Which of them is helping to prove this statement correct that OECD index for services trade is faulty? The data have been generated with the help of members of both developed and developing countries. The index reflects that Indian FDI policy is one of the most restricted policies. Change in one policy area will lead to a change in another policy area of STRI. STRI indices take the value from 0 to 1, where 0 is completely open and 1 is completely closed. We have to identify which one of the following is not helping to prove this statement correct. So we have to first identify which one of the following is helping to prove that OECD index for services trade is faulty. Is faulty because it says that FDI policy is one of the most restricted, which is not true. Change in one policy area will lead to change in another policy area in STRI. That of course proves that there is something wrong with the index. And D is not connected at all. You might be, you know, incentivized or motivated to answer it as D. However, D is not at all connected because D does not prove that it is faulty. It does not prove otherwise as well. However, option A, the data have been generated with the help of members of both developed and developing countries, it means that the data is very authentic and very balanced. Therefore, chances of OECD index for services trade being faulty are minimized through option A. Therefore, it should not be faulty as per option A, which is our correct answer. International Religious Freedom Report is released by which organization? Religious Freedom Report comes from the US, so it is from a US commission. UN World Happiness Report considers the following variables to explain differences in happiness among countries: GDP, freedom from corruption, freedom to make life choices, life expectancy, and minimum wages per hour. Go through UN World Happiness Report. It is available in Indices and Reports section, Indices and Reports document, and we have to explain the following. We have to identify the variables which explain differences in happinesses and variables which are not connected. GDP per capita is used, freedom from corruption is used, freedom to make life choices is used, life expectancy is used, but minimum wages per hour is not used to identify whether one country is more happy than the other or not. Which of the following term refers to an economy which refuses all trade with the outside world? Is it self-sufficiency? Is it self-reliance? Is it autarky? Or is it closed economy? The answer is closed economy. If you don't want to trade with other countries, then you are closing your economy up. Now, what you have to do with this question is understand the difference between self-reliance and self-sufficiency. That is your homework. Although I've already explained it in ESI, but if you have not gone through ESI basic videos, I want you to find out what is the difference between self-reliance and self-sufficiency. That is very important. A question might be asked there. So the answer to this question is D, closed economy. So this is all about this session wherein I have discussed test 4 of ESI. I hope this session is going to help you. In this way, I'm going to cover all the possible tests that I've been giving out to the students. So please, they take those tests either before this test or either after this particular analysis video that I have created. But do take the tests either before or after, does not matter. But do take those tests because those tests will help you, sit in that stressed environment and understand for yourself how many questions can you get right. And, you know, have a certain fair idea about your performance level before you go in for the examination. All the very best. I'll see you very soon with another analysis of another test.